And we back. Part 11. Episode 11. Carthage in America. Doing a little bit more background information. So we starting off again at the beginning with looking deeper into where the term "Moor" is, where it comes from, why we call ourselves this, why you should be calling yourself that as opposed to black. It literally gives you an opposite of who you are. Because of black being slave, are words that delude people. More means Lord, the opposite, a master. You see right here, a mayor, even in Africa. Commander, see, leader, governors, or rulers of even small states, like a chief of a tribe, also a mayor. That's why it's called America. It's the land of the Moorish princes. And you see commander and chief, like a what? A president, right? Even the president is a Moor. Using titles from the ancient Egypt. So even in the Bible. See the Persian style, Mir, Mir Tuzak. A marshal, Mayor Daha, commander, superintendent of 10, the 10th. The Mayor Saman, Mayor Shikar, which is one of the interesting, you see the great falconer. We'll look up the, we'll look at that later, the falcon. And say a pump. Mayor A. Atash, Mayor Atish, chief of the fireworks. And they go on and on. But this MR, we know, come from the owl and the mouth in Egypt on the hieroglyph. Just means somebody who mastered something. Any different things he can master and get them there. See? In Hindu. South Asia. Kashmir. Now you see how United States in courts, they stay away from using the term admiralty in court and try to act like they ain't dealing with admiralty, which would be Moorish law, because you're dealing with the sea. But right here you see al bar. So when they tell you to step to the bar, they tell you to step to the sea. The deal with this admiralty, my guy. Even if they know it or not. Term He returns Admiral. Come from it. Admiral turns with Amara. Baharana, the King of Kings. It is believed that the Canary Islands were known known to the Phoenicians and Greeks, but the earliest written evidence is by the Roman writer Pliny the Elder, who quoted Euba II of Numidia. So he telling you the claim of those islands. But right here, when they get down to right here, they're talking about America. They ain't even talking about the Canary Islands as we know it today. They're talking about America now with this story. In the same area, see what I'm saying? The Santa Cruz, the Palma, the Rosewood Palm in it. Rosewood Santa Cruz in it. And you will find Tenerife, you will find the same thing on the other side. Tenerife, you're gonna have La Palma and Gran Canaria. Right near the Magdalena, right? We talked about in the last video. The Campo de la Cruz. One of these lakes is called Mandinga. I'm trying to find that one right there. So much lakes, I'll never be able to find it like that. Randomly, might be this one, the biggest one. Damn, that's the lakes. See, this islands, they used to call us the Canary Islands because of these reasons right here, right there. Senegal, Mandinga. And Senegal is the Senegal on this side. We're gonna tackle this river, the Magdalena, in this area. Gran Canaria to the new kingdom of Granada to the borders of Andalusia. And Fez to us over here, the Moors in America, that area. So they see they jumped to that area. The Genoese navigator Lancelotto Malocello, who beat Columbus by century, reached the archipelago in 1312. So that's a daddy 2 centuries. And remained for 2 decades until expelled by a native uprising in 1404. The Spaniards began the conquest of the islands, though the first landing on La Palma was in 1405. It took until 1493 and several bloody battles until the last resistance of the natives was broken. So you see, they want you to believe it take this long to subdue La Palma over here. But they gonna act like the Americans ain't take that long to subdue shit over here. On the outside, we already subdued after 1492. By 1500, they already got setting up everything. They want you to believe that. We got La Palma. They want you to believe they take a century to subdue that little shit. But just being us close to the island, supplies would be easy to transfer. Conqueror of La Palma was Alfonso Fernandez de Lugo. He the pre-Columbian who, the reason why Columbus come behind him because he could register everything that he considered conquered. Who defeated Tanausu. And you see names gonna be just like Moorish Americans, just like the old people in that area. Gonna have the same names of these people on that in the story. The last king on the island, he ruled the area known as Aquero, Caldera de Taburente. I don't take too long doing this, looking for everything. As we can see, the word Caldero de something can mean it's a lot of places with that. And they didn't even give me the one on this. Oh yeah, I think I see that Taburente. Yeah, right there. Tanausu was ambushed after agreeing to a truce arranged by Fernando de Lugo and Juan de Palma. Now you see, every time they go into detail of what stuff exactly at, and they just telling you where everything at, they hiding shit from you and they switching shit up, and they know that. Because most of these stories, they don't get into the detail of where everything at. Like teaching that they're trying to make you look some way. Slick. You see, converted Gauchi. Same stories. We continue in this Punic War. I'm about to look deep into that today. In this video, I'm about to look deep into the fruits and animals and the tariffs. Despite the failure of the Cerda project, the Pope did not give up his hope and converted the natives. In 1351, Pope Clemente VI, you can see these same characters gonna show up after the they can show up in the same American 1492 story. All these popes, Spaniards, Genoese, French, 12 converted Canarian natives. You see, they've been rocking with, they always had, wherever Europeans went, they always find allies where they going. They always people who gonna be on their side. You already gonna have enemies around, and they'll just go to your enemies and ally with them and fight you. Your enemies will probably get paid to go help fight you, especially if they can't beat you. Mallorca. The era where you got Moors and Andalusia fighting against Moors in America. like Donna Roby, and they battle with Moses and Andalusia. They ain't got time to play with nobody. They advance people in their times. These who we talking about right now on both sides. Kima Runes. You see the area we talking about, right? Cartagena, Magdalena River. Same thing, right? That's where they going at the 1300s to go to war. They set up an evangelizing center in Telde. Until they were massacred. So you see, ain't been easy. That's why the 1492 story been stick out, because it take them a long time. They literally had to wait till we fall apart on our own. We have our sorry, I fight so much wars among each other. Which ain't new, which been taking centuries in the grand scheme of things. Before we get to the story that we all know. But these punic wars been going on since ancient times, Roman, Carthage. Up and down these mountains, the Andes. We'll come back to this Canary Island story. You want to know what happened in America leading up to 1492, and it's the story you gotta go read. You ain't gonna find it under the American section, history section, I can tell you that. You see, he joined his name in the session. Once we see him join, we're dealing with Moorish American history off the top with Niebla, Granada. What's crazy is most of these Moors who've been over here, the people who've been coming from Spain at that time, they already been them. they've been them, their own enemies and shit on both sides. Those Mallorcans had family and ports and shit over here and over there. The Nieblans, people in Seville, Cadiz. And not just this area, the whole continent, the foe, but more in Spain at the time, had all kind of ports, and Africa, ancient Carthaginians. We read a lot about that, let's go. Andalusians from Seville and Basque adventurers from Vizcaya and Guipuzcoa. And you see terms like that all over fucking South America. Guipuzcoa, look at that. There's smacking the area we talking about. Set off from Cadiz in 1393. And they write very detailed history about them little ass islands, boy, I swear. like they talking to each other, trying to tell you, like, go to this page and read something about America. Sail through the Canary Islands, going to Fuerto Ventura, Gran Canaria, Huero, Gomera, Tenerife, all in America. Took some 170 natives, including the local Guanche king and queen, and his queen, along with plenty of skins, wax, dyed wood, which they sold as a vote for a small fortune. It was the beginning of the boy finally coming into Europe with dark skinned Moors as slaves. Even shocking to the people, like they even knew at that time. But that's how the war, and I started to engage in America. And it's the same time when the Brotherhood of the Negritos showing up. They show up in Spain, captives, and that's where you're from. Upon the return to Castle Almanzor and Niebla, presented their captives and goods before Henry III and reported that the Canary Islands were easy to conquer and very profitable. Thus were the appetites of other adventurers. Punic Wars in America. They will go through the whole gambit. 1572, Portugal. He can be brought back to Iberia from King Amalahugi. See all about converting Punic Wars, Roman carpet, Moors and crystal. But then they get rid of all this to start with the New World story for American history. The Biscayan privateer. Daughter Eco, we talk about the King Guana Rame. Yeah, you know all the places that call Guana. Guyana is in America. All of them. Spell like that. Let's check. Let's see if they got a spell like that on the other side. No, they got the H. And the Guyana version. Some of these terms we don't got. Then we got Angola and Namibia and Gabon, I know that. Nigeria is Nicaragua. And of course we got plenty Ghanas, but spelled like that. Like that king, right? G-U-A-N-A. Guanabo. That's where your boy name is, Devin. Columbus homeboy, he been from here. And Columbus been coming over here to mess with that man. Like, this shit is crazy. Guanabaro, Guanacaste, go all day. Guanahani been the first island they claimed, El Salvador, aka Guanahani. Lanzarote is supposed to be the Canary Islands. Guinea-Gada, another place. 13 survivors. 1385, see how detailed it is now. Second, remember one a second, We gonna get them later. We see B and L, and we see Bob. We see these terms like this. So let's read about it. Say sakun yatan. In the Greek, we see sakun yatan. We see names all over the world like this. We're connecting it throughout this video. Say absatsasam said. Thought, and fresh ones are continuing to be discovered. See, fresh ones are continuing being discovered. It was custom among the Moorish Phoenicians, as among other Semitic nations, to use the names of the gods in forming proper names, and thus to express devotion or invoke favor. Thus, Hani Baal or Abd Melkart, Hani Ashtart, Eshmun Azar. The proper names further illustrate the way in which the relationship of man to God was regarded. The commonest form of servant, Abd Astart, member, Arlem, Bard, Melkart, client or guest, Ger Eshmun. The religious idea of the guest of the deity had its origins in the social custom of extending hospitality to a stranger and in the old Semitic rite sanctuary. Sacred objects and worship. Like other Moorish Canaanites, the Moorish Phoenicians offered worship on every high hill. So that's where we get the mount and owl and the pyramid, making the myrrh or the more modest a mound or a pyramid. Put the temple right on the top of it. And under every green tree, which is the sacred grove. But to judge from the allusions to sanctuaries and the inscriptions and elsewhere, the Baal or Astart of a place was usually worshipped at a temple, which consisted of a court and enclosure and a roof shrine with a portico or pillared hall at the entrance. And the court sometimes stood in a conical stone. The symbol of Astarte, as on the Roman coins of Byblos, stone or bronze image of the gods, were set up in the sanctuaries. And besides these, the Bytilia, the meteoric stones, which we regard as a symbol of the gods. Pillars, again, had a prominent place in the court and before the shrine. The inscription mentioned altars of stone and bronze, and for the sacrificial tariffs, which have survived, we learned that the chief type of sacrifice among the Moor Phoenicians were analogous to what we find in the Old Testament. So now you'll be able to see in these names and stuff like that too, that ain't really no spookism, the simple stuff that we always do, and still do. That's what we're talking about. Hieroglyphic use are the sound sign MR on the left, followed by the owl in the mouth. So they basically explain that. But they just explain the word pyramid, where that come from. The more, say, which are both sounds complements. The I was the M and the mouth is the R. The last hieroglyph is the pyramid determinative. This glyph was used in individual names of pyramid complexes. Let me see some more. Stories on the Canary Islands in 1483. That's 100 years later. Guillermina Semidan. All the names look like this. You see, Fernando de Lugo, they buying things now. They 700,000 Mirabides. And that's how they end up with the hikey endos and stuff. No, I'm telling you, they tricking them, boy. One of them dude, they ended up leaving, getting free. Cause he was so annoyed with them boys, said, man, we can't even enslave him. they were trying to break him. And man, keep his head high and just going, and they ain't ever harm him or nothing. So he leave. But he ended up being a slave, captured himself, but he been capturing them, Castilians. And that's another American story, you know, coming back over y'all and being a cap, being a boy enemy. If you just look at how big this place is, this whole, we're talking about a continent now. We ain't talking about one part of the continent. Talking about a whole continent, and we're talking about a long time period. So you can imagine how much stories and legends that just become legends and stuff that we don't got. You see annexations. Annexed the island of Tenerife to the Crown of Castile. They back to 1464. For this reason, 32 years passed between the first attempt until the island final conquest in 1496. You see, after 1492 now. So now Columbus finally get the right Colombia for dominating. Being the one who they say in the register, but Fernando de Lupe should have been the one who get the name because he did the fighting and others for Castile. But they've been still calling him the Kingdom of Fez. They've been calling him according to what we've been calling him and behind the scenes. And they're conquering it. Now it's Tierra Firme, stuff like that. New Spain. And the Moors who've been back and forth from just Andalusians and speaking Spanish and Latin and shit. Some of them from here too, they've been calling it the New Kingdom of Granada. So sometimes you use that name, that's why you see those, all three of those names used for that same area. See right there, Tierra Firme. New Kingdom of Granada, Thierry Fermi, because he's different perspectives, as it should be. Everybody ain't grew up in the same households together like that. These large pockets of groups of people. You don't see that today. You see different groups of people with different family sets. You see, the only one they definitely ain't gonna show you is Kingdom Affairs. They ain't showing you that. I know Thierry Fermi ain't the only one, about three of them. The province of Thierry Fermi. New España, but that's some of the New Andalusia, but on the other side. No, I like New Andalusia, but counted as that too. Yeah, pretty much the ports. This for the stories for the, with all the King Guanajuato and all them boys fighting. This the Canary Island stories. Grand Canaria been us to them. They been like, this the Great Island. The Great Canaries down here. They start up here, a beachhead set up. All the way down to Peru. And that's Castile side. But Portugal already been here, Knights of Christ, Templars. Story get deep. '1492, that's the year. That's the same year. The governor of Gran Canaria, Francisco Maldonado, organized a raid ending in a disaster for Europe as they are defeated by the Guanches of Anaga. 1493, Alonso de Lugo obtained the Catholic monarch's confirmation, the right of conquest over the island of Tenerife, and in exchange for renouncing the Napoleon's promise for the conquest of La Palma, he claimed governorship of the island, although he was not received revenue from the Quito tax. Quito, just like Quito. Same type of terms now. Playing with us. Yeah, I show you Tenerife over here. It's definitely La Palma. You see even more La Palma than that one over there. Trickers, the fact that they, the word island tricking them, because they're looking for an island as we know island today. But if they go close up, see, I understand Castilians just learning about what's going on. They're just learning about the shit. But it's still an island when you go close. Water going all around the shit from so much rivers. You gonna go across them rivers. Eventually, you go across so much. They just islands. Like this. That's, you see, the sector of the black land. That's what Portuguese would call it, Africa, land of blacks. You can find a lot of these sectors in this area. You've got places called Moors. And of course, next to El Dorado. We'll look up that. We'll look for that. Very important. because that's what we've been all about. Gold, battle for gold and silver mines. La Tigra, we're going to talk about that river. Talk about the Dina Miles, the Holtway Miles, also the same group. The Holtway culture, Southside, considered a religion by the archaeologists as well as a culture. Holtway Marabouts probably had a higher social ranking with merchants and warlords beneath them. Due to the greater concentration of people and their culture, the Holtway Berbers depended more on agriculture and grew a variety of crops. Their extensive villages were almost near water, always near water. And that's what we're saying, rivers and coastlines. As opposed to the round African style huts used by the Adena. Holtway Berbers, like the Adena Berbers, constructed a variety of earthworks. Many of their mounds covered multiple burials, standing 30 to 40 feet high, large animal-shaped effigy mounds, often stood nearby as the geometric enclosures. Some of these earthen works were 50 feet high and 200 feet at the base. And this one, Newark, Ohio, Serpent Mound. The Berber Canaanite artisan mastered both the realistic and abstract styles. The bountiful and beautiful grave goods unearthed by the archaeologists, including ceramic figurines, copper headdresses, and brass ornaments, obsidian spearhead, knives, mica mirrors, Gucci, drinking cups, pearl jewelry, hammer gold silhouettes. So what we're seeing is the history that we've been going through in this series from different parts of the world, minus this part. We're going to look at what they claim they find. So many others, we're going to look at that later too with El Dorado. Because these same empires stretching from North to South America. Many other North African connections can be demonstrated. Holtway Mile at Davenport, Iowa, containing carving of an elephant. Unknown to the New World, which is not true. We'll look at that later. Experts on both sides of the Atlantic concluded that a nearby inscription was North African Berber Tifnag. Other Libyan and Iberic inscriptions were found in Tennessee, Arkansas, and New Hampshire. All over, and even, and now we speaking and writing in the same language, just in a new form. The conquerors narrate feats and anecdotes, but they do not extend describing the context, given the absence of certain species due to absence of mention. So, the only absence because it ain't been mentioned. Unpleasant, the presence of the camel on the Caribbean coast. Recorded by some, it was concluded that the Castilians gave this name to the flame, also known as a sheep, forgetting that the species, typical of the Andine Heights, it's not adaptable to lowlands. Superfluous archaeological excavation on a newborn continent whose history was elaborated by deductions. The finding of the city, write history and do the archaeological works were already based in mind that this a new continent, like, ignorant. It's because the Spanish call it the New World. They think it's actually new. Like, that's ignorant. Say, whose history was elaborated by deduction to find out two fans, such as Jefferson and Lincoln, were not taken into account by the scientific world. Passing mound tombs without comment. Centuries later, geologists found bone deposits, remains of camelids, horses, sheep, bison, mammoth, and various mastodons were mixed with clovey tips. So that means with man. Man and ancient animals. Being particularly suspicious and forgotten. Elephant tusk deposit exhumed in the Sao Tome region in Brazil. Accepted the presence of the bisons, obviously. That of other cattle was denied, without prejudice to Fernando de Oviedo, describing and drawing the Dante cow and Zebu cow, endowed with the hump in the Cordillera, typical of the tropics. As for the chuka of black hair, yellow hands and feet, with a bag on the belly, where he brought his children. It would be for us the moose cat of tasty meat if it did not have a geographic representation of a kangaroo, different from the Australian because of the color of the hair. The post-Columbian reference to pachyderms link with the pre-Columbian mentions. Portuguese navigators who were in Guinea had encountered with elephants, especially in a Nilo, which could be the Orinoco or the Amazon. Let's check and see if the Nilo's still around. Put in the Lima district. Screet, the real Neil, a screet. If you look on old maps, you can find it in this area. You can find the real Nilo in the same area. But I can't find it when I look for the modern. It might be out of place for some new registrar. From the church. And rare with rhinos, therefore it is not surprising that confirmed the monopoly of Portugal over the Kingdom of Fez. You see, that's what they were calling it. By 6th to 4th in 1470, Alfonso the Fifth, in addition to closing its waters, declared royal gifts, plants, and dye woods, orchilla, algalia cats, and unicorn teeth. And that's what they were putting in the unicorn teeth, which disappeared justifiably the dramaturgical virtues attributed to elephant fangs were less appreciated in 1478. Catholics who still were called kings of Portugal, considering Guinea conquered, they authorized the recipient of the fifth with diminished power to issue license to rescue slaves and elephant teeth, quote unquote. Tusk. Solomon imported ivory from the land of gold, and the Duke of Medina Sidonia, who died in 1507, had elephant tooth, quote unquote, from Guinea. A probable relic of the last pachyderms was swarmed through America. And Edison, common sense will tell us that the ones that in every museum and zoo all across the continent is the one. They just capture those ones and put them in zoos so they wouldn't be out in the wild, and tell us they bring from some other continent. That's what happened to them. They collect all the animals. embark with other goods. We gotta go into tariffs. We gotta go into goods tariffs. Embark with other goods to take them to sail to England. And the Portuguese ship Santa Clara, it was stolen in the port of Kitwater, where the winds put it in by armed caravel of Fernand Darius Saavedra, who brought people from Tarifa in Spain. Beautiful Guinea, the owner claimed the scarlet over 26 years. It appears in a tariff in 1491, being recorded in those of the 16th century as a genus of the Indies coming from New Spain. So now stuff started to get more clearer, but we've been seeing it go before New Spain, before those terms and Indies. But when it come down to that terms, we can trace it back to where it been before and those clues. And that's an example. Barbary is not mentioned, but it is known that in the Safi port of Sharif, it was bought in a Mahdi. I don't know what that means. So the Guzman introduced prickly pear and insect in the terms of Cornel and Chiclana. He produced Al-Kabbala in the early years of the 16th century. Until inconsiderate catch and altered the climate, he destroyed the horse without damage to the habitat, which spread throughout Andalusia. There's trade going on between America and Andalusia. But again, the Guzmans, they used all those Spanish terms like India, Indies. They had the real terms. The rosewood owe its name to the smell, rosicus. Until it hits red, it is appreciated in marquetry, appearing in the old tariffs as a genus of the Canary Islands. So that's a term that those records show. But as we still talk about America, it is found in Brazil and southern Mexico, having been exported by the English colony of Belize. And look how you spell that at that time, Belique, which competed with Guatemala and the Indigo branch. So again, connecting the newer version, once the British get involved, the English colony of Belize, once they start getting into this trade, they trade backwards before that, and we're catching it when they were called Canary Islands. That's how we know that. And the Indigo branch. As for yellow palm wax, it appeared at an exclusive cannery of Barbary. It served to make candles and varnishes produced the palm of Guinea, which grows in the Maranon Desert and the Amazon Basin, having found Antonio de Ulua at the source of the river. It was exported by Sharif, being a product of Safi. Committed the name of the palm tree. So you know that's going all the way back to Carthage. We deal with the land of palms, right? Historians came out of the quagmire, explaining the land owner conquerors imported into Brazil, spread prodigiously while it became extinct in the homeland of origin. A privileged deed, it was called the palm of Carnuapa. When we look at that on Wikipedia. Port of shipment wax. Carnuapa. I only got a page on this. I spelled that wrong. Yep. Yeah, they say Brazil. cosmetic mascara. So you see more spin on it. They already used this tree since ancient times. They ain't give us no history. I know they know what it is. The American origin of corn is not disputed, although it was cultivated in Granada before 1492. According to Alonso de Palencia, who had nothing to hide, Henry IV prepared the entry of 1456, planted them in summer on harvest, and in autumn the millet and corn crop for 5 years. That in 1507, the Duke of Medina Sidonia had sown and harvested corn in the municipality of Vigia, from which it was brought from the Indies. So he did sometimes use the term Indies. So it lead us to wonder why the conquering Christians stopped cultivating it, and we assume that the same thing happened with sweet cane. According to the Dicar, it was cultivated in, and that's that map that show everything set up by climates instead of seven continents. Let's see. It was cultivated in Negron, a city of Yemen, with two torrential rains, winter, and two crops. Erik the Red, colonizer of Finlandia, compared the noise of oars with the crash of corn grains in a possible simile of not knowing the cereal. In case anyone questioned the pepper in America is American, Fernandez de Iwedo gave us a plastic representation of the plant. Aboriginal people called it chili pepper. It was used everywhere in these Indies and Tierra Firme, known as Menigueta. And that's what they confuse on Wikipedia with the Guinea pepper, which is the same thing, but they see the word Guinea and they go straight to Africa. Well, I never already know that. Money quit. Afro normal Malagueta. The grains of Selim. The Shanti paper. So you can see the going in when it comes to foods and plants and stuff. That's how they trying to trick us. You see, it is a native to West Africa, which includes America, Western Ethiopia. Yep. Well, I tell you, when they go out their way to tell you where something coming from, they hide something else. Anyway, it's in North Africa. They'll get to America sooner or later. And look, Alonzo the First stories. They already know the Gulf of Guinea. Now you see, after Christopher Columbus, now we can come to America. They tripping, they jumping from coast to coast, but this one story is the same story. We reading it now, and that's how they telling you. And we telling you that the pre-1492, they go from 1469 and deal with the Portuguese in Guinea. The exclusive trade of Afronomum Malagueta. They ain't called Malagueta pepper. The grant came at the cost of 100,000 maravedis. and agreed to explore 100 miles of the coast of Africa or America per year for 5 years. This gives some indication of the European value of the spice. Then they jumped to Christopher Columbus in the New World. Try to act like that's happened to us. About to look at the CNN, Marigueta. The Spanish and Portuguese spelling. The same thing, they just try to act like a different thing. You see, in Portuguese and in 15th century Castile, there was a rescue of the Manigueta in Guinea on the coast of its name. The Navy formed by the Catholic in 1475 went to the islands of Africa and Guinea to bring gold, slaves, and Manigueta. Oviedo described the fruit as the red and green pods. Some round like cherries, burns a lot, but not the largest ones, which you can eat raw and not burn. A important producer in the Mexican province of Chiapas, French Guinea, and the English Jamaica. Easily acclimated chili pepper, like the Guinea eggplant, has spread throughout the world. And that whole coast was called Guinea to Portugal. All this area, the whole thing really, because they've been Africa, our land of blacks, that are the Knights of Christ. The peninsula occupies certain ports, and that's an Albala that's very important. We're going to read this again later in another way, straight from the Albala. The peninsula occupies certain ports. The environment of the mine and operation and good parts of the empires for having inherited a centralized organization. So you already been organized and centralized, like I say, since before even Carthage, but they are inherited it from their fathers. You still here today, you just ain't know what going on, just out of your mind again. But most of the continent belonged to lords elected in Beatry, subject to the superior authority of the King of Fez and Morocco. This reality does not hinder, so that some Indies controlled by the King of Spain are described as the historians suppose that Castile was being left out of his authority at most lost corners of the interior. So basically saying, even while history telling us 1492, 1500, all the way up to, that's why the United States had to deal with the Beys and the King of Morocco and stuff like that, because they're telling you that Spain and Portugal and all these people hate doing all this stuff, but look how big this place is. They can be just in small areas doing shit, but the history books make them look like they Superman conquering people, bringing people on big ships from Africa, enslaving them, do all kind of wild shit. That's a fantasy. The story's so intricate, you never get through the whole thing in one lifetime. So you see, this reality does not hinder, so that some Indies controlled by the King of Spain are described as the historians suppose that Castile was. For the second must have believed it, because in 1579, Indies have files in the court of Portugal to reach the throne. You see, a at all, even for the second, and started to forget about the true history of what was going on with the walls before them, because they already been resetting it before him. So in need of vows in the court of Portugal to reach the throne, he wanted to ingratiate himself with Diego de Miranda, to whom the elderly King D. Enrique, 40 ducats per frame, who entered with Ghanaian fish. So he been connected with America, so just for a second try to get in touch with him, which because he been a Habsburg, he been Castile, so he ain't really, he been just getting into Portugal side again in 1579. The Huelvans, returning from fishing, from the corporal called Borgador to another cape called Seneca, we saw that earlier, were surprised by the attacks. Addressing the king, they put him in front of his reality. To penetrate the nets in the Ghanaian waters, they paid for the formage to the Sharif, because they admitted that they were in prison, without the peninsula monarchs being able to prevent it, because the land was possessed and lorded by the Moors, so that the king of Portugal or his majesty did not possess it. And that's what Diego Miranda tell him. Having no other rights to the fishery than to the Mozafes or to the Alcazar of Morocco, which belonged to the Moors. Having arranged King D. Enrique of others, the one from Spain, made merce of something that was nothing nor as his majesty's. Overflowing with common sense, they advised the most famed monarch of his time to suspend the effect of bliss and mercy for when Essen possess and conquer and win that course. So 1579, they stole the honor, and he thought they did because of the Columbus thing, all that fiasco that happened centuries before him, 1492 and shit. Having no indication that 1492 aspired to the continent known today as Africa, it's evident that they were talking about the American continent. And Fernando de Vierotine, Darien native, stayed in shops in the manner of the Arabs. 100 years later, Francisco Roque, Philip III's agent living in Mazagon, commented, "In Barbary, there is nothing more than a field, and the houses are made of canvases, which it is necessary to do it and provide for them to go to the Hellas, always with the maintenance machine." The palace of Muli Sidon, King of Morocco, was Al Mahalla of shops. Visiting Safi, Murata, and with masonry customs, he planted the court camp in the town. The gold medical mentioned in Saleh by Ibn Battuta in 14th century traveler ran in Morocco. In the 17th century, it was worth that of Morocco 400 maravedis from Castile and 420 rays of Portugal. It is likely that it materialized in the 1520 carat gold roof that the Tierra Firme used per coin. So we know we're talking about on our side, Tierra Firme. Not wanting to lose the fifth Carlos the First order stamping them, exercising the trade of rehearsal, custodian of the DA in Santa Fe, a black man, quote unquote, of Gaspar Nunez. Let me see. Still today, modern day Cartaginense, the Archdiocese of Cartagena, Colombia. The Knights of Christ stay under the, they stay under the fake storytelling to bring, because all the Spanish do keep bringing attention to this, so. And we're going to finish after. Let's see if we can continue with the Punic Wars in the West. The Carthaginian side map. See, in decline did the dynasty of Fez. In decline the dynasty of Fez, reigning in the 15th, Muhammad the Qa'im, descendant of Muhammad, true or supposed, passed to the Sus. And she said that because we have plenty more all over the world with that claim. And they records. But the fact that they in Arabia that would got scholars head mess up. They be all the way in America making that claim. Cause you got a meaning. Imitating Yasin, he preached a Quran adapted to the local mentality. A good connoisseur of herbs, his cures earned him magical powers. Promoted to Marabout or Santon by his followers, preparing for the future, he made his children study in Cairo. Moles from all over the world are saying, charging to Egypt, to the temples, learn that old knowledge again. Heirs of the kingdom is pro undivided. They have to face Alfonso de Lugo. And you remember, that's who Canary Islands, right? Canary Island stories where he's been a conqueror, so called. So we're dealing with the Kingdom of Fez now. Under that version, Portuguese Protectorate of Algarve, and that's what they're calling it. As soon as he felt safe on the throne, the Sharif Mohammed decided to reconquer it. Starting with the campaign in 1541, he was followed by Marbel, future Sulu historian of the Alpujarras, as a distinguished captive. He owned the Sharif, most of the Sus. And that's another term for that area right here on this side from this river going this way. When Charles V published the Car of 1543, he prohibited putting into these Indians or Indian kingdoms, where the free are wanted to come from as well, or from those who pretended to be slaves and that they truly are. Even Charles and the boy are no difference between Moles and the wild man. And they ain't even want the wild man to be around. Anyway, we're gonna start right there. And we'll come back in the next one. Continue what tons more of what going on in this Punic War in the end of the series. With that, peace.